Okay, so this is not really going to be a talk towards a specific problem. What I've done is I've put several things together and tried to give you a message about something which is very important in the study of complex systems. It's not very obvious to people unless you really see these things when you're working. So I will just give some examples of something like what happens when individuals get together and they interact, and how is that group supposed to be behaving. Before I do that, I would like you to, all of you who are interested in complex systems, you should actually look at this. Okay? So I won't say this is all there, but this is the primer, and this is the one which I think everybody should take a look when they start. This is their, they have a separate web page, but it's part of Scientific Institute. It's interesting because there are lots and lots of videos which you can see, and the most important thing is you can get a feeling about what are the kind of things that's being studied or being taught or being considered as under complex system. Okay, so if I come and tell you do this, this is complex system, somebody else comes and says do only network or do only game theory, that is not all. I mean, it's kind of a very, very beautifully varied area where you can use a large number of methods to study the properties that one talks about complex. So this particular course was created by Melanie. She has been part of Scientific Institute for a very long time. She also published a book which was a bestseller and all that. The thing which I really envy her is that she was a PhD student of Douglas Hofstadter. I don't know how many of you know the name. Have you ever seen the book called Godel Escherbach? That's his. If you haven't, please get a bit educated. These are things which you must study if you're doing science, okay? This is something which you have to, okay. I can keep giving that kind of lecture. All right, so here are the kind of things that are covered in both in the book and through several videos. And you can see some of those things we have done in the course, but some of those things you have already done in your courses maybe, but you thought that maybe it's something else. For example, dynamical system, nonlinear dynamics. It's generally taught fairly well in most places. I know ICER it's taught. I personally work in that, fractals. Lot of work on information order and randomness. You will hear some today on order and disorder, phase transitions. Some of these stuff you have heard of, networks. A very major area is scaling. Scaling properties, I think Stefan probably has something on it, but I don't know. But these are major areas where people have been working, and they're all part of complex system because they're approaching to study the properties of so-called complex system from very many different angles. Now there are nice videos, and there's one video which says that what is your definition of complex system, okay? So now I have that video over there. I'm not going to tell you about it except to show that there are about six people who have been interviewed in that, and each one of them is interesting, and you can see that. Okay, so it starts with him and ends with one of the earlier presidents, Jeff West. He's the current president of Santa Fe Institute. It's very interesting to hear his, it doesn't match with mine, but you should see this, okay? So I'm not going to show you this. There are some very important, each person looks at it in a different way. For example, right after this is Chris Moore, who's a computer science person. And he talks about complex system completely from the complexity, algorithmic complexity point of view. There are some people who talk only about agent-based modeling, some people talk about scaling laws. So it's really very interesting to see, to hear this. And through all that, there are some features which keep coming out from each person's definition. There are some features which keep coming out as a constant. One of them is that the one I will quote here is, of course, one of them, but... get out of this. So this is the one which I've quoted. You can see it's told in a manner where things are not exactly one after another, properly said. But this is something which is there in almost everybody's, when Mark Newman said, when Stephanie Forrest said, many, many people, when they gave their own definition, something which came out is that a system which has a lot of interacting parts, and you've been hearing it, in many talks, a lot of interacting parts, where something, the way those parts behave when they interact is qualitatively different than the way they behave if you look at them individually. So as I told you that my talk title is also From Individual to Collective. So there is something that is happening when things are put together and they interact among themselves in a certain way. And what comes out is not always what they, if you look at them individually, that is what you get. So that's why it's called the emergent phenomena. And that's some of the examples that I will give today, all from biology though, is how you study those things with real problems, okay? So that's what I want to, that's why I wanted to introduce this to you. Let me just do the basic things first. How do you define a system? You define a system in a very simple mechanistic way of defining a system is consists of components which are interacting or interrelated or interdependent in order to facilitate flow of information, matter, energy to form a complex whole. So this information flow, the structure of the system, which is also part of the environment, and then the way the parts interact is something which differs from a simple system to a complex system. And a very kind of simple way of looking at it is in linear systems you always have the principle of superposition holding, whereas in complex system it's beyond that. Okay? And I like to show this cartoon where you all of you have one of these kinds at home, that you give them a toy and they break it open to see how it works, then it doesn't work. Because they can't put back all the pieces that should be next to each other in order for the information to flow about the car moving. I think one of the very good examples of a complex system is ecological networks or food webs. You may have seen in your school books these, they are very commonly seen. This is a kind of, what is the feeding relationship of different fishes and at different levels of the food web with each other. It's a network. You can see one is connected to the other through feeding relationship. Now, if one of them is taken out from this network, how the network is going to behave, it's not obvious for us to predict at this point. So the ecological networks have been in the forefront of study of complex networks for a very long time, because these are real problems, and this is where these words like keystone species and things come up, because there are certain species, if you take them out from the network, then the network breaks down. There are some species which are peripheral. If that goes, then the network doesn't really become very, doesn't get broken up. So these are very interesting things in biology, at least, where you can use the where complex system is actually coming out in front of your eyes. You just have to get the data to plot them. You can ask very many different kinds of questions to study this kind of networks, and these are all the different things. Okay. Keystone species is one of the most important things that one tries to figure out. They're not obvious by looking at it, not the highest degree, not the highest clustering coefficient or not the highest betweenness and things like that. All right, so back to Doyen's statement. I have just put in red whatever I want to talk about, that the way those parts behave when they interact is qualitatively different from the way they behave when you look at them individually. Okay, and that's where behaviors or phenomena come out, which they individually do not show up. All right, so I'm going to do few examples, which two of them are from ecology and epidemiology, and they're very, I would like to start from very simple. You have a single population growth model, which all of you have done, I'm sure. It's a logistic map. Then you have two couple discrete equations, which is the simplest model for host-pathogen interaction, host-parasite interaction. So these two are from ecology, epidemiology. And then I have another two, I hope I'll reach till then, which one of them is, there are cells in our body which secrete insulin, we know that. They are called beta cells. They actually stay in a bag-like structure, which are called islets, and how the single cells, when they are taken out, how their electrical activity is and how it is when they are in the islet, which is essentially required for their function, the synchronized activity. I will just show you some model results there. And the last one is, again, similar, but here, the cells, this is a very general model. I had written several papers on this, that we all know that cells, the function that cells have are all due to the in their internal biochemical pathways. So what we do is we take a very simple pathway and take cells which we think that those cells have that pathway, and then we couple them, make a tissue out of it, because tissues are made of cells, and then we see how the single cell behavior and the tissue level behavior, how they differ, how they depend on the properties of the environment, properties of the size of the system, properties of the parameters and all that, okay? So let's see till what point I reach. They're all different papers, so I've just put them together. All right, so for those who have forgotten what biology is, I'm just giving a very simple picture for those who would like to know what a discrete model for single population growth is. It's given here. It's the simple logistic model. It's discrete, that's why it's T and T plus one. So the population size at a particular time point decides what is going to be the population size at the next time point. Okay? And that is kind of it's the growth of these, reproduction of these species are in discrete manner, like the children don't see their parents. So the parents all die after laying the eggs. Okay? So here are some insects. Insects have a lot of those. So once the adult insect lays eggs, the eggs become these crawly things, larvae, then they become pupae, and then they become adult. And once they go and lay eggs again, these adults die. In the lab, you can do that by just letting the adults fly away. That's how we have a fair amount of data to study population dynamics. But this is a single species discrete population growth model. And if you know the number of adults at a particular generation, then you can predict it, given that R is its growth rate. And this is, it grows when there's no density dependence, when it doesn't get growth doesn't get regulated by large numbers, then it grows kind of linearly, it's R into H. But when H becomes large, the number of hosts become large, then there's a negative factor that reduces the population size. I'm sure many of the physics people have done this, they know how it looks and all that. Now, how do we go from here to two couple discrete equations, so host parasite? Now, there are many parasites which what they do is they go and lay eggs on these pupae and they infect the pupae, so the pupae don't hatch and they don't become adults. But in the process, these parasites actually grow in those pupae and they grow themselves. So this is the interaction picture. So this is how in the pupae these eggs are laid, and then those eggs are give rise to the parasite adult. Then this parasite adult goes and lays more again. So what's going to be the model for this? Very simple, depending on how the interaction is happening. In this case, we assume a Poisson kind of a interaction between the host and the parasite. So this exponential minus term comes through that. B is the interaction or the searching efficiency of the parasite. R is, as usual, the growth rate. Okay, you can see the assumption here is the parasite grows only on the infected pupae, and the host grows only by the non-infected ones. So that's why it's this is 1 minus this. This term is calculated using a search, Poisson search. This is all textbook material. Now the question is, does this interaction, so you see there's an interaction, okay? And the interaction doesn't seem very linear anyway. So what happens? How is the population size going to be regulated? We all know this, I didn't even bother to do anything about it. So we know that when you're looking at the single population, this is how the dynamics looks. Like for lower values of R, the population size goes to stable, and medium values of R, it oscillates between two values. So when there are no parasites, the host is going to behave like this. At high values of R, it shows chaotic. Okay. I would like to know what happens when there is interaction, okay, interaction between two species. So in absence of parasite, that's the, how many, I hope all of you know a bifurcation diagram. Maybe one or two people don't, but how many people don't know what a bifurcation? Bifurcation diagram is very simple. You understand this time series, like how the population size is going to change with time. All one does is takes, let's say, 100 time points and plots it in the, takes the x values of these, the population size, and plots it. So this is population size, and this is the value of R. So for, let's say, for this value of R, for 100 time points, it will be the same point, and that's what it's a single point. For another value of R, there are 2 points. So you can see 2 points here. It's a compact way of showing dynamics. So we would like to see that just a simple interaction with another species, highly nonlinear interaction, what does that do? So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at I'm going to plot the bifurcation diagram for this. So now there are 2 species, so there'll be 1 for H, 1 for B. I'm more interested in seeing that if H now has a parasite interaction, is it going to change or not? Is the dynamics going to change or not? So that's what happens. Here it is. So this is what it was supposed to do when there was no parasite. When the parasite came in, so now there are 2 species interacting. So let's say I started with the parasite, the host population showing chaotic dynamics somewhere here, R equal to 4 or something like that. And then the parasite is introduced to it. So now R mu or R whatever, it's 4. And with a certain value of beta, that's what has been plotted here. With a certain value of beta, now P kicks in. So which means H population is going to be modulated. But look at this. It immediately goes from chaos to stable. So it is not very obvious to you. If you just look, you will think, okay, the number will reduce, that's all. There's parasites, so the number will go down because some of them won't grow. But this is what is kind of nonlinear interaction. It goes to a value which you won't even think of. And there are lots of things. So the red one is for the host and the green one is for the parasite. And you can see that just the presence of another species, which means presence of another interaction, so these are values where they have been plotted here. This is quasi-periodic. Okay. So in the presence of single species population dynamic gets altered due to ecological interaction. Okay. So that's one way of looking at multi-species interaction is almost impossible to, so that food web which I showed you, it's almost impossible to predict unless you write a model, solve the model, and see it. So it's just not being complicated, but it's something which you are unable to see the result, unable to predict what's going to happen, okay? Unless you put in some of these things. Okay, beyond this, what we would like to do is, we would like to see, okay, there's a patch where this host and parasite is kind of growing. They are, it's like a patch you see in your agent-based models kind of stuff. There's another path, so there's some host and parasite populations are growing here, some are growing here, and then they migrate between them. Okay? Now this connected populations are called metapopulations, and they play a very important role in the population dynamics and population, the abundance and distribution. So I will just show you some examples for it. So how do you model it? So obviously, just as in agent-based model, the first step is to take a grid and then decide. I'll tell you what's the difference between the two. So I decide that I'm going to allow migration to the nearest neighbors, and I put a grid like this, okay, exactly the way you did in ABM, except that now each of these nodes in the grid actually have a population of H and P. So patch one is, let's say, here, patch two is here, patch three is here, and things like that. So it's not one individual. For example, they're not a single turtle or a single individual sitting, and then you frame rules and tell this, you move this way, you do this, and you do that. The entire activity of the host and the parasite are given through the equations, okay? So, and the equation, this set of host and parasite population is sitting in each of these. And how am I going to model the migration? Nothing. Let's say I'm here. This particular patch would get host and parasite from nearest four. So this is, you remember what neighborhood this is? This is Neumann neighborhood, von Neumann neighborhood. If I did it for all eight, it would have been Moore neighborhood. Okay, you can do all eight also. It's up to you. You can do next nearest neighbor also. So it's all. In fact, all the people who work on chimeras these days, they actually take multiple neighbors. And, it's a very active area to work on these days. That's another emergent phenomena that comes out where you absolutely can't predict when it's going to come out. Coexistence of a stable area along with chaotic in space. Okay, so this is space, and these are the populations, and they are the simple diffusion, diffusive movement. So they are doing D1 and D2 are the diffusion or the migration rates of H and P, and this is how they are going to move. Okay. This is my equation. I'm going to just simply simulate these equations in my computer. Of course, you can see this is discrete, so this is like a almost like a rule-based thing. When you put continuous differential equation, it starts getting more and more complicated. So what do you see? So what am I going to see? I have taken a two-dimensional lattice metapopulation. So these are called lattice models. Lattice nodes are populations, they are not individuals. Okay. So each node have a host parasite subpopulation, and there's this dispersal among or migration among four nearest neighbor. You have to worry about boundary conditions. So this is with no flux boundary. This is what you see. Okay, so this is my grid, let's say 50 by 50. So there are 50 by 50 HP subpopulations growing and moving around here. And what do you get? These values for the growth rate and the interaction rate are given here. If just for mu equal to 4, beta equal to 3.5, when there is no space, what do you get? You actually get this. This is the dynamics you get. Okay. This is the one. But when they're interacting in space, when they're migrating and going from one point to the other, then things do change. And things change, and you get suprastructures, which span much more than single lattice nodes. And these are structures which is the right kind of example for emergent behavior. Because this structure has gone over the entire lattice. There could be many more variations of these. The spirals, very favorite of physicists, especially nonlinear dynamics people. So that's what sets up. So this is the entire lattice. It's a two-dimensional lattice. So this is a snapshot at a particular time point. So all the sites, even if they started with different phases of the dynamics, they have reached a synchronous state. So all of them are at the same dynamical state. And So let's say if this was repeated 100 times, as Bill told you many times, that none of these should be done once because you're starting with a random initial distribution of H and P. So if you do 100 times, then 93% of the cases showed complete synchronization, okay? All of them reaches the same dynamical state, but this is time. So all of them are the same dynamical state, so same color, but they change with time. This is the intrinsic dynamics, the quasi-periodic. But 7% of the cases show this, and you won't be able to tell which ones. This is where the emergence becomes very important because you can't predict. Okay? Now, what we did after this is, we wanted to see that this is not how most of the time the landscape is. The landscape will always be heterogeneous. Okay? It's not so homogeneous, everybody has the same property or not. So we wanted to look at what is the role of heterogeneity, which is another very strong point in complex system research, that when the agents are not same, when they're heterogeneous, does it affect? Or if it affects, how? Environment, structure of the system, agents' properties, and information processing within the system, these are all very, very important things. So what did we do? We just took the same lattice and we sort of randomly took some sites, some percentage of sites, and said, okay, you can't go there. No population can go there. No host or parasite can go on these red ones. And then we redid the whole thing on this lattice. So whichever was accessible, we put the host and parasite. The way we do it, we put host on all of them, then put parasite on few of them, and then through migration, the parasites keep moving, and from a single host, it becomes an interacting host-parasite system. So what happened? Did it at all affect? Well, it did affect quite strongly. So this is what you see. Almost, as the number of these kind of vacancy, we call them vacancy, as the number of these vacancies increased, the number of synchronized states went strongly down. And for just 5% of the lattice site being occupied, being vacant. So if you have done a 200 simulations, then you see that only few of them show synchrony. All of them show these patterns. So this is another example to show that the structure of the environment regulates the population dynamics and the behavior of the population sizes. So this is very easy to do. These kinds of problems are very easy to do, but they are important in ecology. So we published this in ecological modeling. So it just, as you increase the number, percentage of destroyed sites in this 50 by 50 lattice, there are other things that one can do. One can look at the scaling laws and all that by changing the lattice size and all that. You don't have to worry about that. So what is happening? We are finding that increasing vacancy increases the asynchrony in larger number of lattice. So they are becoming asynchronous. They are showing an emergent pattern. Okay, so the collective behavior, emergent collective behavior, is shaped by the structure of the environment. These are not very obvious things. Only when you do these things, you can see. So for the single population and host parasite, I will stop here. There's more work in this in the paper, but I don't want to talk about it because I just want to show you how pervasive it is in nature. So obviously, it is pervasive in social science also because we are all part of nature. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about this problem where I have these cells. These cells actually secrete insulin. They remain in a bag called islet, and these islets are in our pancreas, inside our body. Okay? So these way the insulin is secreted in our body is very interesting. These cells, they are called electrically active because they have membrane oscillation, like nerve cells. We have few types of cells in our body which are electrical, nerve cells being the most talked about, but the cells which kind of heart cells are also electrical cells. So what happens is only when the membrane oscillations are, there's a synchronous membrane oscillations, right after that, so it says membrane oscillation precedes insulin secretion. If the membrane oscillation is in some way disturbed, insulin doesn't get secreted. So one of the ways of treating diabetes where insulin secretion is hampered in type 2 is trying to see if there is some problem with the membrane or any drug is interacting. So obviously, this huge amount of communication and interaction among the cells which are inside the islet, that's going on. That's true with any tissue, whether it's our skin tissue, whether it's heart, whether it's brain. There has to be communication. Communication is one of the most important things, important parameters in complex system. If communication stops, there's no interaction. Okay? So that looks something like this, just for the sake of how our islet looks. This whitish thing is the islet, and it's kind of very small, as you can see, and they have about few thousands of cells. The beta cells which secrete insulin stay in the core, and so there are two types of cells actually. Beta cells form the core, and there are some other cells which are dark. They are the non-beta cells. They secrete some other hormones. Okay. So what do we do with it? People have shown that this is experiment, okay? So they wanted to do recording in the islet to see how the electrical activity is. Because, well, in biology, theory and modeling should go hand in hand. So what did they see? They took an islet, so this is schematic, and they put two electrodes, any two cells, so there are a large number of cells here, they put electrode in any two cells and measured the electrical activity. So this is cell one, this is cell two, and you can see that inside the islet, both the cells are highly synchronous, okay? Perfectly synchronous, they just beat at the same time, okay? So because the entire islet's electrical activity is highly synchronous, that is why insulin gets secreted. If this gets spoiled, insulin secretion is hampered. So the NIH has a whole group of people working on these things. So that's fine, good. Now, what they did was, the experimentalists, they took the islet, it's a kind of white tissue bag, and very carefully they took out the outer tissue and took the cells out, put it on a plate and measured the electrical activity of each of those cells when they are not in the islet. And what do they get? They get this. Okay. This is the single beta cell firing pattern when you take them out of the islet. When they go into the islet, they all synchronize, and they synchronize so beautifully that they all are. Okay? So obviously, modelers are, you know, they find these things very attractive. So there are different types of, you can see different types of oscillations. So there are spikers, bursters, these are called plateau cells. The time scales are, the most interesting thing, the time scales, which are very important for physicists, the time scales are highly different. Some of them are seconds, some of them are milliseconds. And so with such a wide variety of time scales, oscillation, each cell is having oscillations with such kind of time scale, but when they get together, they get to set into a single time scale oscillations in a beautiful synchronized manner. Okay? The question is how? Well, I don't know how, but we can just see if the model can say something. So now how do you model? This is a slightly more complicated model, because this model is based on the neural model also. And neural model was based on Hodgkin and Huxley's model, who in 1952, only genius can do that, that they found these, they set up their physiologists, and they set up these models. There was no computer, they did some hand cruncher, and they fit the model functions to data, because experimentally you can measure data, and found out the shape of the function. Those days they didn't even know what the variables are, but they had such good idea about the system that they could write down these equations. So being an electrical system, we have all done RC circuit, okay? So this comes from the Kirchhoff's law. So membrane capacitance given, the rate of change of voltage across the membrane should equate the sum of all the currents, school level, okay? Now, what are these currents? how do I know which current is? For example, this equation for heart cells will be slightly different because heart does not have calcium so much. Heart has mostly sodium current, whereas in beta cells, calcium channels are very important. Okay, so calcium current, potassium current, S1, S2, they didn't know what they are. So they are, now people know that they are all different kinds of ion channels. One of them have slow time scale, the other one has a larger time scale. This is leak, which is all pervasive. There's always some ions leaking across. Then they found some other. What are these eyes? These are the functions which they had fit by hand using experimental data, okay? So that's why I said it's a bit complicated. They found out which is what. This is fast calcium current, this is fast potassium current. There are some inactivating current, inhibitory current, etc. All biophysical journal of physiology types. And then they had to figure out what the other parameters are. So if you ever get, go and read these papers, there are two papers in each paper is about 50 pages or so, and they're so beautifully thick papers and written how they found these, okay? They're all kind of fit from experiments, and there are lots of parameters which one can find from experiments. I did not do any of the experiments, so I just took the numbers. I took the numbers from other people's work. Now, how do I model the islet? Very simple. All you do is put several RC circuits together, okay? So now, how do I model this? So the way I'm going to model this is exactly the way we did the earlier one also, except that was discrete. So there are three ways you can do. You can, generally what people do in differential equation areas, they will include space in partial differential equations. So they will do PDE models, okay? They will include the space and they will consider that the cells are distributed like this. In the other end is the agent-based model. So each cell is an agent and you can see how they are moving or what are their properties. There's something in the, I call it mesoscopic. There's something in the middle which is kind of called cell dynamical systems model, which is the one which I said, it's called couple map lattice, which I used. It's a lattice-based model, and each of the lattice nodes have the dynamical system on it, okay? So it's neither completely continuous in space and time, it's neither completely discrete in space and time, it's midway, the time is discrete, but the space is not. If you're using a map, time is also discrete if you're using. All right, so what do I do? So I use that. Why do I do that? I mean, not too many people use this in biology. I do it because cells are discrete entities. They actually are discrete entities which have their own dynamics. So they are much better to be looked at as they are kind of entities that couple through, in this case, sharing of voltages. So two cells next to each other in the lattice should share voltage. In the other case, they were moving, they were migrating from one to the other. In this case, in the tissue, they share voltage, okay? So this is how it looks. So all I've done is I put three RC circuits in series, okay? And what are these? These are what are known as, in the membranes, they have small gap junctions which have certain conductances, and the two cells which are touching each other through gap junction can sense the voltage of the other one. This is how information is getting transferred from one to the other, okay? And now I just take each of those. This takes very long to do because now the equations are the Hodgkin-Huxley equations. For each of them, there's a whole set of seven Hodgkin-Huxley equations there, and then they are sharing information about their voltage status through the simple the voltage of this one minus this one and this one minus that one. Okay. So that's the interaction part, linear interaction, and you can see this is the Hodgkin-Huxley equation. What does it do? Does it do anything at all to the dynamics of the? So here is one simulation I would like you to see. So what is being shown here? You can see a lot of MATLAB pictures. So there are 50 cells, 50 RC circuits. 50 cells, they are interacting with the neighbors, nearest neighbors. It's a linear tissue through sharing of the voltages. This is when the gap junctional conductances are zero. So there's no information being transferred from one to the other. They are independently going up and down. Okay. The moment you switch on anything positive here, which means now voltages are being shared, so they are interacting. When they start interacting, this is the after. If I put such a large value of gap junctional conductance here, then slowly they all, it takes a very long time, zero is here, it takes very long time, this is time axis, this is the lattice site, it takes very long, but then they all synchronize. You can see the perfect synchrony there. How does it look? So if you look at the time series, you can see these are the four different types of cells that were taken with four different time scales, and they were put like this here. So when I say graded GS1, for each GS1, that's a parameter, the burst frequency changes. So I put it in such a manner so that the faster ones are here, the slower ones are here. This is a linear kind of gradient. Now, then I switch on the gap junction, and after a while, after a long time, they are all synchronized. The problem was, when you do such work with people who are doing experiments, they say this will not work. Even though you have got nice 25-second time period frequency, this will not work because it's very high value. So the whole work was to figure out how do I change these cellular properties so that I reach low values of GC but right values of time period of oscillation. Okay, so I'll just show you the last slide here for this. So what we found was, what I haven't shown you in the other experimental results, where people have actually measured gap junctions inside the islets, and they have shown that there is not one single type. It's a bimodal distribution of gap junctions, so there is a reason to believe why gap junction should be also in some way, there should be a distribution of it. Okay. So then there are other things like that to be looked at. From experimentally, these have to be found. And then we found the best possible combination is where you have good, nice, well-synchronized burst, which you saw experimentally, and with a fairly low value of GC is when you have this kind of a combination. So there's a lot of timescale interactions here, like low GC, high GS, etc. They have all opposing effects, so that has to match. So what we like to say is, during development, these distribution of cell properties actually set up this kind of function. Now, I don't know whether it makes too much sense to you. For biologists, it makes sense, because what happens during development when cells develop to form a particular tissue? So these are the kind of things that happen there. Okay. So to summarize this part of the, then I'll go just to the last part. So you can see the islet architecture, which means the specific distribution of the cell properties. Again, the architecture of your environment is actually deciding what would be the function of, what would be the time period of the synchrony is not a problem. Synchrony comes very easily, but to get the right time, frequency of synchrony is very important. Okay, so those are all developmentally. So there is a dynamic relation between cell property and burst frequency, and that's what is highly nonlinear. I haven't been able to find the relationship, but if one works, one can. Now there are many other types of things that you can see in biology where you have these kinds of effects. So these are waves. Okay. So this is a calcium wave propagating across an egg, frog egg. Now, so you can see it spans many, many. The, yeah.
A couple of slides back, I showed two graphs. So, is that basically a cellular automata and then it's
rating at every step? No, it's not a cellular. Cellular automata is very, again, it's a single agent which is making a decision. But these are equations, so these are population level behavior.
So, but you can look at each row is basically a cellular automata, right? Then the next step is updating the next step. Isn't that what that graph is?
If you want to draw any spatiotemporal plot, you have to draw it like that. Now, whether that your time is a single time point or whether it's small dt or delta t, that depends on whether you're using continuous system. So in this case, these are all differential equations. So it's continuous time. So I decide how much time I would. So it's not discrete like cellular automata or agent-based models. They are all discrete. Okay. So the color bar was there. So frequency. The value of V, the voltage. So how do we explain these kinds of things which span not a single cell but multiple cells? So this is one example of one of these very interesting phenomena in biology. There's another thing which, these are transient temporal patterns. These are called sparks, puffs and all that. There's a puff, these are sparks. So these are again calcium waves. So when people does imaging, so from a tissue, let's say skin or skeletal tissue, sometimes suddenly some amount of calcium comes out. Absolutely no, it's like one of those, high temperature behavior. But they'll come up, but where they will end or whether they'll continue or not, it's very difficult to predict, okay? So I will show you some of these things in a model and what you can make out of it. So these are the other kind of things that one would like to explain using models, and for that I will go to before that let me just show you the boundary condition types. So the tissues always have very nice structures. Okay, so this is the root tissue of a particular plant, this is the epithelium, this is the skin tissue of a fly, and you would see that there are all these boundaries are there. We never really work with, you can do it if you want, but we generally take either a linear two-dimensional or at the most hexagonal, like that, the lattice type, that is what we take. But this is how it should be. What I do is, for this particular root tissue, I always use a circular, so periodic boundary condition. So the last row of cells is what I'm going to consider as my system. Okay, leave that out. So what I'm going to the last part, where I'm going to look at cells with certain types of biochemical pathways, okay? Now, biochemical pathways are complicated things. Every cell has large number of biochemical pathways because every function a cell does, whether it divides, it experiences stress, it makes some molecules and all, they're all regulated by chemical reactions, okay? And just the bacteria, E. coli itself has 6,000 of it in it. So we have millions. But they are highly networked. This is the latest work in systems biology now, where you will have thousands of these reactions going on and you have to make a network model and predict what is going to happen if you make a mutation. Okay? It's almost very difficult to just look at it. So in for our case, we just want to say that there are biochemical reactions and there's a network of reactions, and these regulations of these biochemical reactions are through feedbacks. Okay? Positive and negative. So what do? I take a model cell. Let's do simply. So a model cell is composed of a biochemical pathway which has one positive and one negative feedback process. Simple. Let's look at the simple one. We'll then think of looking at complicated one. How does it look? This is how it looks. The three substrates, S1 goes to S2 goes to S3, and then S3 feeds back positively and S3 feeds back negatively. You can see there's a huge push and pull going on here. Here S2 to S3 is growing, and here it's being inhibited. So S1 goes down, then S2 goes down, but then S3 comes in. So again, time scale interaction problem, okay? So we want to study, if I have a model for this kind of a pathway, I want to study what the single cell dynamics is, and when I couple these single cells, what will the collective dynamics be, okay? So I will go, there are about 6 papers that are included in this, but just to give you a flavor of how it is. So cell-cell communication, of course, is very important. So what do? We basically take this, first we just go fast on this. Let me take the model first, and how do I make the multi-cell model? I just again do a one-dimensional model, and here is exactly like the RC circuit. Here are my cells. This is the ith cell, this is the I minus one cell, this is the I plus one. Each of them have this equation, which is the biochemical pathway. This is the negative feedback term, this is the positive feedback term. And these epsilon, these are fractions, epsilon is between 0 and 1. So certain amount epsilon by 2 is going here, it's going there, and from there each one of them is sending epsilon by 2 of their own concentration back. It's a typical diffusive interaction that you take. Okay. So what did we do? We looked at the role of local cell dynamics, and it does, this model does show a very large variety of dynamics for different values of parameters. Then we looked at system properties, that is coupling strength, lattice size, and the different types of connectivity, how they alter the system properties. So what is the single cell model? The single cell model is this. It's given, this one. Every time I wanted to edit it, the crashed. So this is the whole model. Okay? This is my ds1 dt, ds2 dt, and ds3 dt standard differential equation. You set it up by looking at the chemistry of it. So these are all chemical kinetics, and then you write them. So you can see this is the negative feedback, because if you increase z, that is S3, then this function goes down, and this is the positive feedback. Okay, so this one has the negative feedback, this one has the positive. All this given, some numbers are there. These are actually obtained from reactions which follow similar kind of network behavior. So what do we get? I will straight away show you. So what we do, what everybody does in this area is, once you get an equation like that, you have to first do analysis. You have to try and see if you can at least get some steady states. You can do some kind of eigenvalue and all that. Obviously, most of the time you can't, but at least up to some point, you do your local steady state analysis. You do eigenvalue of analysis around those local steady state for small perturbation. And you get some idea, analytical idea, that what this model can do. So what I'm going to show you is those are standard maths. There's nothing special maths there. It's just complicated. I'm just going to show you the results of simulations. Okay. So here is a particular value of Q I have chosen. So I have two parameters that one is, all other parameters are fixed. So I put one of them fixed and I'm changing one. Okay. And as I change one of them, this particular model keeps showing very many different kinds of dynamics. So these are phase plots, if you know what a phase plot is. So there's x1, x2, x3, that is s1, s2, s3. So here I'm plotting between s1 and s3 probably. You can plot between s1 and s2 also, either way. So that's a phase plot. So for low values of k, you get simple limit cycle oscillation. As you increase the value of k, this small one kind of bifurcates and a large oscillation comes up. Okay? Completely, you see how nonlinear it is. And then this one keeps kind of period doubling, goes through period doubling. This one also starts becoming complex. And then as it keeps going up, that shows chaotic dynamics. And as you keep increasing k, then it comes out. And at this value of k, it is again a same single limit cycle oscillator. Interestingly, these two have the same time period but different amplitude. So we discuss these in terms of what mutations can do and all that. It's no point in looking at talking about those things here. In the paper we discussed. So what did we get from here? That this pathway can show a whole variety of different kinds of simple and complex and chaotic oscillations if I change a parameter. Okay? But in lower value and higher value, it's either period doubling or simple oscillation. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take each one of these, couple them in a linear lattice and see what does the lattice do. Okay? That's what I want to show, that individual behavior is this, but what is the collective behavior? Okay? So that's what it is. So there was, as you may have noticed, there was something called coexistence of two different limit cycles. These are all coexisting. Okay. Now we wanted to see what does that mean, which means for the same parameter values, it can show two different types of behavior. Okay. So if you look at these and want to characterize them, you see that you do the standard chaotic stuff that you have to do. So you do the power spectra, you do all these things to show. This is the three-dimensional plot. You can see the smaller oscillator is pretty kind of flat. The larger one is taking spanning a large, lot more space in the phase space. So we thought we will be able to decide that, okay, if you do this, you are going to reach the smaller limit cycle. If you do this, you can reach the larger limit cycle. So we wanted to find out what is known as the basin of attraction. And we wanted to, when we tried doing it, we got a fractal basin of attraction. Okay? So imagine such a simple model, and there itself, all these things have come, okay? All right, so the first thing that happens is, that comes to your mind is, God, if it's so complicated, intertwined, what will happen if this particular system encounters noise, which is all around you? Is it going to just move from one to the other, which means it won't be able to show any stable dynamics? Okay, so that is where the question of collective behavior comes in. Does collective behavior stabilize these kinds of noise-induced stuff? Okay, so that's what we did. We went through each and every K here and went through the same thing. You take about 50 cells. You put, first you don't allow diffusion. So when you don't allow diffusion, each cell has a particular value, particular type of oscillation. They are all given by this. That the moment you allow diffusion, they are all kind of nicely, for certain values of diffusion constant, they nicely synchronize. You can see that they were all in different phases, and now they're. So they and this is pretty robust. Okay, you make a little change, it will come back there. You obviously, in that one, I used the K and Q values for all the cells the same. That's not the case. You can have heterogeneous parameters. So what you want to see is whether the heterogeneity makes a difference. It does make a difference if the heterogeneity is too much. If the heterogeneity is small, that is, you have a value of K and then you put a small random variation in the value of K and then take those cells, they still synchronize nicely. But if so, you see, you started with two different types, fairly kind of different types of oscillations, and then you reach nice synchronized small oscillations. In this case, because the variance is much higher, so they try to synchronize, but they don't. But I'll show you later, even these things with simple connections, they can be synchronized. So basically, in biology, what one can say is that you start with several genotypes here. Genotypes are essentially different parameter values, K and Q, but the system shows a single phenotype. Okay? Now, these are pretty, these are things which are not obvious because people think every phenotype is representative of a particular genotype. But here you can show that when you are looking at a systems level, you can see that there's a combination of multiple genotypes, but when they are interacting and they are communicating with each other in a tissue, this is in terms of cells, you can see a single phenotype. Okay. Then, of course, there are these standard things that you keep on changing the number of cells, you keep on changing the diffusion constant, and you get complete synchronization, intermittent phase synchronization, you can get phase synchronization. You start with this, and then you get all these different things for different values. They're interesting. If you read the paper, there'll be much more discussion on this. You do the standard analysis of what is known as trying to figure out the order parameter and all that, which people do to study synchronization. So here, this is with cell number. So you increase cell number and see which are the, keep the epsilon fixed, let's say in this, that is diffusion constant is fixed. You are only changing the cell number. You can see there are only few cases where you get synchronization, rest of them are not properly synchronized. Okay. So local dynamics is still chaotic, but the global dynamics is different. Okay. So these things also can be looked at in terms of innovation and stuff like that. Similarly, if you are changing the coupling constraint, keeping the size the fix, then you can see that you get, there are some values where you get phase synchronization, but not in all. So let me hurry up. You also can get traveling waves. You start with something like this. When they are uncoupled, they are so chaotic. But when you put the switch the coupling on, then you can get wave-like phenomena. Even though the local dynamics is still chaotic, but they have organized themselves in such a way that they have local dynamics chaotic. They have the, all of them synchronized, but kind of set up a wave-like phenomena, as I showed you earlier. And then you can also suppress this chaotic activity completely, and then you have some kind of a global pattern formation. So people who are interested in synchronization, chaos, pattern formation, they find these things very interesting. I am, so I do. This is a very interesting piece of work where you start with something which is not properly synchronized. All you do is you add a few global links, which means long-term links. And this is the person who has really specialized in this is my colleague, Sudeshna Sinha. She, anything she gets, she puts global links. And she this is a work with her. So interestingly, even with just so few links, so if you take 100 cells with the probability of this, you can see that something which was not properly synchronized actually is. So few random long distance interactions reinforce completely the synchronization regime. This is very important from the point of view of, you don't have to think just that these are cells. You can think of anything else, any agent, any system which behaves like this. Few links actually synchronize the entire system, something which was trying to, was a little asynchronous. So biorhythmic cells also show two different types of synchronized behavior, whatever you start with. Then I'm not going to talk about this. There's a paper in EPL on synchronization, stability of synchronization state, because this is with Professor Rangarajan, who will teach you the time series tomorrow. This is, for me, this is a little interesting because it has some biology in it. So what happens when you have a synchronized lattice and you add a little bit of perturbation? Okay, so there's something like robustness. What we saw is all the values are given here, and this is what you just take one of these and pose. You see, the perturbation value strengths are different, but some of them have not progressed at all. Some of them have actually spread out. This one is increasing, and this one is just gone on. Was there any pattern? There was no pattern at all, in fact. There was no pattern. It is not that if you increase your strength, it will kind of start doing this. This is not at all high. So it completely depended on the phase at which perturbation acts and the coupling strength, and not on the perturbations. These are kind of things which are not obvious in many of these complex systems, which are interconnected systems. So this is what we essentially, I've just concluded here with some points which I think is important, which if you look at each of these properties from the point of view of some general feature of a complex system, you should be able to, there are lots of jargons that go around in this area, things like inventions and all that. So you get things which the individual cells don't even know. They are doing things which they never did on their own, but in a group they are doing. So they have actually invented some stuff when they are in a group. So suppression, synchrony doesn't necessarily require strong interactions. A small degree of randomness actually leads to synchronization. So that's kind of is very important in any activity where a large number of people are involved. Then there is this stuff in developmental biology, you get this. So when they are primarily, the synchronized behavior may not be the same as the single cell behavior, which is very interesting. So this is something where I'm of a type, and when I'm in a group, I become different. Okay? you take me out of the group, I will go back to my type. But the moment that that kind of interactions, you see this only in these type of complex systems. So genotype, phenotype is a developmental biology stuff. So what we think this kind of studies do is they give you that why does it happen? Why do we, this also takes us back to some kind of questions on why did cells have to become multicellular? Why didn't they just live like single cell? So the evolution of multicellularity is a big question, that what was it that required nature to go from single cell to multicellular, just like origin of life. Origin of life is a big question in complex systems. So similarly, evolution of multicellularity and all that. So they kind of give you clues that increases your general understanding that how using these kinds of features, what is it doing? It's actually essentially increasing the collective robustness of this. Because in nature, we are always coming across noise. So you saw that the in the face of local complexity, these kinds of connected systems actually are more robust. So I will end here. The several people whose work are here, and this work is slightly dated. I don't work on this anymore. Several people worked on it. I had collaboration with all these people, the early papers. All the papers in physics journals, physical review letters, PhysReview, EPL, Physica A, complexity, this, that, and all that. Okay. So we have we had some funding from DST. If you discuss with interesting people, you always have interesting ideas. So it's always good to be able to go to places where they think differently. And of course, thank you because you patiently listen to me. And thank you many, many times. I learned it how to do. Things to thank you many times. Okay, I don't know if whatever you got, I would be happy if you got something, but.